name is Asha Marler, and I'm from Albuquerque, New Mexico.
You got a clap.
My name's Alan Hamilton, I'm from Edinburgh in Scotland.
I thought you did something heavy.
I'm Janelle Hadnott, and I'm from Oakland, California.
My name is Yashima Bett Turner, and I am originally from Philadelphia, but I moved to Pecos, New Mexico when I was in middle school.
You might have picked up.
Yannick Rogatz, I'm from Germany.
Austin Brobst, Fort Collins, Colorado, by way of the greatest state in the U.S., South Carolina. Let's go.
That was horrible.
That was. Bring it back. Come on, let's go.
It's hard to describe Yannick. He's German. I think that does a lot of the explaining. He's like really stern sometimes, and a lot of people think he's mean.
That is middle school. There's
because, like, I don't know, he has a weird sense of humor. So he'll like say a joke, but be straight face, and everyone will be like, Yannick's so mean. I don't know why he would say that. But he's really kidding. But it's just hard to like kind of understand his sense of humor. But I think as mean as Yannick is sometimes, he holds people together. He holds our team together in a special way.
Yannick was always, like, I had to admit, when I first came out here, he was always the one that was like, right, I need to follow this guy. This guy knows his stuff. This guy knows what's what. And I mean, I'd probably say he's my best friend on the team, has to be. I mean, this guy's always here. I mean, if something's been shit, he's been there. If things have been good, he's there. He's always there. And not even just for me, but for the whole team as well.
Fuck. Come on.
Certain people tend to freak out in certain circumstances, or you know, implode, or whatever it may be. But Yannick is one of those that, in competition, he's Yannick. You know what you're gonna get. Now, practice, you might have a ball of fire on your hands sometimes. But in terms of competition, he's the seasoned vet.
Shema, she's her own individual person. Like, she's awesome. If things aren't the way she likes it, she'll tell you.
I feel like you're not doing anything.
I just feel it right. She is one of the older ones on the team. I'm one of the older ones on the team now. So I guess that mature thing, knowing what the program has been and what it's come to, and very well seasoned, I guess is how I would say her role was.
Janelle's just always the positive, happy person.
She's our kid. She's the kid.
She definitely is the kid in the family. No, seriously, like, when you come to practice and you're in a bad mood, and I don't know, like, Janelle will just cheer up the whole thing.
Janelle's like the sweet little like baby girl. So she's the sweet little sister, and everyone loves her.
I mean, Janelle's always the one making jokes, always the one that's there and like sees you like, oh, you're not looking yourself. Always there to give you a hug. So Janelle's a massive pick me up.
You can't take anything Janelle says seriously. I mean, there's very few things. She's always got always laughing. She may not have a smile on her face, but she's always laughing.
Alan came like straight in. He had no shame in his game at all. So he was real cool like from the beginning.
Alan is the baby, I would say. So he's like the spunky, running around toddler that is like me. That's what Alan is.
Go!
He's the little brother that annoys you sometimes in a good loving way.
But Alan is definitely a vocal leader. And I think he kind of stepped in and filled that role. And he has diva tendencies, but let's be honest, that's everybody in track and field.
If we want to say Janelle's the child and Asha's the mom of the group, I guess that's the way it is.
Asha is probably the one person I admire more than anybody else, without being harsh on anybody else. Just because of what she does. She can come out and put it on the track. She comes to train every day. She puts
110%
in everything.
Just keep myself up.
I think that Coach Austin is one of the more quiet but patient and personal coaches that we have.
He's certainly a very relaxed coach. Like, you won't see him outraged or anything.
He's, as a coach, probably still a bit inexperienced because of his age and the time he's been within coaching. But that's also quite a good thing because it means we're open to new things. And he's open to new things.
His relationship with everyone is totally different. It really is. In good ways, it's personalized that way. But at the end of the day, he wants us to be together and a group. And he cares. He cares so much.
I feel like the way he is with us kind of rubs off on our group. So that's why we are so close to each other and we always hang out with each other and talk, and everyone's very close to each other like a family. And Coach Austin's kind of like the dad.
Everyone's there. Everyone's always that there. Like, just, it's just there for you. Toll pick me up when we're having bad sessions, competitions aren't going great. Just up in the training room, chilling, chatting, you know, just the way it is with this kind of family, I guess.
They are my family. They go through the same stuff every day. I mean, I don't see many other people every single day.
It's like a family out here. Like, I mean, I'm pretty far away from my family, and so that's basically my family replacement. Who doesn't like to have a family?
Preseason is huge. It creates that momentum that you're going to carry into the season. You know from a solid preseason that you haven't missed anything and that more than likely you're going to pick up indoors and just roll with it. Preseason went well. Pretty much everyone put together a solid 16 weeks, 20 weeks of training, and it showed in their performances. They were hitting marks in the weight room that they'd never hit before, hitting marks on the track that they never hit before. And so that really just gives them as an athlete and you as a coach kind of that reassurance that, they're on the right track.
Preseason is hard, but you feel good at the end of it because you're in shape.
You come back to school. It's the beginning of the school year, not feeling the pressure of school yet. Came back from summer, you're in a good mood usually. So it's fun seeing everybody. You get the new people, okay, so-and-so, new people out there, and kind of gauging where everybody's at. Who looks good this year? Who's looking strong? Who didn't work out this summer?
We tried some new things on certain athletes. Janelle tried to switch legs, which currently, we found out it didn't work. But at the same time, it wasn't a complete loss because it made her stronger in her non-dominant leg.
I'm a left foot triple jumper. So in triple jump, you land left, right foot into the sand pit. So since I long jump left and I triple jump left, technically it would be right if I went right, left so that I can end on my long jump foot. And we tried that. And I believe I can do it, but it just takes time and we didn't have enough time.
I don't think I had a preseason. I'm just thinking back to that. Well, what would have been my preseason? November, I guess. Well, starting in October is kind of like the real when preseason starts. I was barely running.
She's always had a bugging knee. It was diagnosed as a partially torn meniscus. Like I said, hindsight's always 20/20. They went in, did the surgery, found out it wasn't torn, so they just, you know, cleaned up the knee. And that kind of set her back a little bit coming into this year.
This was an MRI that I had in December 2013, and my hips were bothering me in January 2014. They kind of correlated the two. And everyone, I guess, thought it was best for me to get the knee surgery because I was redshirting outdoor anyway. At the time, I wasn't all for it. And looking back, I would have done it. But everyone thought I tore my meniscus. And so when I went in for the surgery, I guess they opened me up, scoped my knee, and saw that my meniscus was intact. And so there were, I guess, scar tissue, loose scar tissue around my knee, and I had some plica, and so they removed all of that and closed me back up, and it was a very frustrating rehab process, let's just put it that way. The trainer that I previously had, she was planning to move to a different sport, and so there was a time where I think her intentions were good for me, but it wasn't really focused on me, like the desire I had to get back to 100%. Eventually, we got a new trainer, and she was extremely eager to see me get better. I started running, I think, maybe 3 weeks after she got here. And probably the best thing that could have happened to me as far as my knee surgery. And so she probably was the main person motivating me to get back. And I mean, besides my coach and my teammates, but it was every day with Sarah. So it was like, I finally had somebody that said, okay, well, if you work hard, you can get back to it.
If individuals have trust in you, then you're gonna be able to do something special. And the team really trusts Sarah. The coaching staff trusts Sarah. And I think that that's the most important thing, and especially for the athletes. I mean, we as coaches have whether we like it or not, we have a big impact on the athletes. And the fact that they can see we trust Sarah really helped them. But in terms of what Sarah brought to the table, at first it was just probably a new set of ideas. Enthusiasm. You know, Sarah's she's very good at her job, and she's enthusiastic about her job. And I think that really helps the athletes. What we did is we left on a Sunday, got up there, trained Monday through Thursday, had a meet on Friday, and then trained again on Saturday. And what it really did is it just gave, I think, the athletes a motivation to train over break, because you can have that, you know, lackadaisicalness that happens the 3 weeks they're away. And it really gave them something to push towards. And then as a group, it just gave them a chance to bond.
It was great. You know, a trip like that or a training trip like that does a lot of things, right? You know, you have a group of people that are there for the same purpose, the same goals in the back of your mind, but it's still, you know, it seems a little bit far from when your season starts as well.
It was definitely a training camp. It was a lot of bonding because we were in the house together for so long, every single day. So I guess it was really like getting to know each other as athletes and as people, like put together, rather than at practice, you only see certain aspects of people. But in Colorado, we definitely got a full taste of everybody. Hands down, the best part was when we played Just Dance in the house. That was real wavy. Everybody was dancing. Some people didn't have any rhythm, but it was still good.
I think that Coach was trying to make sure I was included. He didn't have to take me on that trip. I wasn't even ready to do anything at that point. And I appreciated it. My motivation, I guess you could say, was dwindling. And the Colorado spring trip was the first, I guess, training that I had done with the team in maybe over, I guess, about a year. for me, it was more about the camaraderie, getting back with the team, the squad, as we call it. but yeah, I appreciated that trip. It was good training.
There's a lot of commotion at a track meet because so many things are going on at one time. You kind of don't hear anything else besides like yourself breathing. All I really think about is like running as fast as I can control. And then pretty much the rest of it is really a blur until like the last phase into the pit, and it's just like trying to reach as far as you can to get that dent in the sand, I guess.
Well, when I made that jump, to be honest, the first thing I felt was relief because I had scratched the first two in prelims. So I'm super stressed. I scratched the first jump. I tend to do that. Not proud of that, but I scratched the first one. Then I went through my second jump, and I just see Coach Austin going like this. So he's stressed. I'm stressed, and I'm like, all right, gotta get this mark, you know. He's walking me through it, and we both know what I need to do. It's just a matter of doing it, you know, mentally doing it, not overthinking it. So at this point, it's like, okay, you know, you just gotta get a mark to get to finals, or, you know, well, not even just a mark, it was a big meet, so it's like two things going at once, like, all right. So I go and I get the mark, and I, you know, immediately I look to the board, and I see 5:23, and I'm like, oh my God, that is so bad. And I was super angry for about 5 seconds, and I look at Coach Austin, and then he's like, he has like kind of like a half smile on his face, and he's like, not bad. And then I look back, and then it was 6:23. So I was relieved, even more so at that moment. And then, of course, I was happy.
I mean, I think as a whole, indoors, everyone built on the previous week. So for me, indoors is hard to look back and say I wasn't pleased with it.
I think I always enjoy indoor season because I never experienced indoor season when I was in high school. So like, it's always kind of special to me to have that because I've had outdoor, so like that's like nothing really new, but indoor is kind of like a closer, more intimate kind of situation.
I didn't plan on competing this indoor season, so when I talked to my coach, I said, like, when do you think we're gonna get back to jumping? And this was a conversation I had with him maybe in like December when I was actually like running a little bit more aggressively. And he was like, well, if you're planning on coming back next year, then we're not even gonna compete you this indoor season. At the time, I wasn't really sure if I was coming back, and it wasn't a decision that I had definitely made, but I knew I wanted to compete even if it was unattached. So I think he saw my eagerness to get back onto the track, and he tried his hardest to kind of accelerate my workouts. And so I think my body was a little shocked when I decided to go out and compete at some of the indoor meets.
You know, her and I had some long conversations, butted heads a few times, which is part of the process. She wanted to compete indoor, wear the uniform the entire time. And at the end of the day, you know, we decided let's use it as a red shirt. And if, you know, you progress the way you should and get some of your coordination back, then you very well could compete at a conference meet. For the team as a whole, I mean, there's no better experience. You know, you sacrifice your Friday nights for Saturday mornings in the fall. And at the end of the day, you want to see some sort of value come from that, because I mean, you know it, I know it, college is fun, but if you're, you know, going to bed at 10 o'clock on a Friday because you've got to wake up for an 8 a.m. practice. You want to see some sort of, I guess, reward or something come from that. So for them, it's just a gratification.
I wouldn't say I obsessed over it, but I was excited. I mean, it was a countdown, like, you know, I kind of feel in your gut, okay, 3 weeks, you know, 3 weeks, 2 weeks, okay, you know, be ready. And really just trying to think about, I mean, personally, just trying to get school stuff out of the way so that week of, I'm not dealing with that, and I'm just focusing on conference. So the momentum and anxious, you know, nature builds as it arrives. And yeah, it's my last one, so I wanted to make it count.
So the decision came after it had been brought to my attention from her that she didn't plan on coming back the following year.
And then I finally made the decision, and I talked to my coach and said I wasn't coming back next year. So he allowed me to compete at the conference championships, which I appreciated. But I don't know if I was really ready at that moment either.
She had a great practice the week before conference. We were doing some triple jump technical short approach jumps, and she put out, you know, work in practice that, you know, kind of told me that, okay, she can score at conference. And so I sat down with her and I said, you know, I think it's a good idea for you to compete at conference. It's going to be your last indoor. Obviously the women have a shot to win it, so why not be a part of it?
I don't know, the conference trophy was like in the middle of the track basically the whole 2 days, and you just walk by that trophy and you're like, I really want to win this, and I'm going to do whatever it takes to win it. And then if that means going into a different event, of course you go in a different event and just do your best. And then
no one on our team is supposed to score, but you know, our coaches were like, you need to do this right now. You need to get me some points. So actually, it's quite funny to actually come out and be like, okay, we do one session. It's just like not even a full session. It's just like, oh, we're just gonna do some standing triple jump. We're just gonna do like one or two, like, jumps. Like that's it. And then, oh, you can jump in the weekend. Great.
If we had messed up in the triple or in the high jump, nobody would have blamed us. But at the same time, we get the opportunity to do really well, surprise, and get some really decent points out of it. And so it's the ideal situation you can be in as an athlete.
I mean, everyone knew Alan was good. But then he did that and got second in the triple jump. And then Yannick did well in long jump. But then he like scored really well in high jump, and everyone was amazed by that.
To go out and do what he did in high jump, of all things, you know, was really impressive. You know, Alan was equally there as well, in terms of the triple jump and just events that, you know, we don't really work on. But I would say that those two definitely really surprised me.
That just went so much better than I thought. I mean, obviously I was hoping for a good performance, and I was confident I could jump 2 meters. And then it just kept going and going. And that was individually for me, definitely the best moment of the season, of the indoor season.
The first day was an emotional train ride.
It went, long jump went.
I know Asha Marler was very disappointed, kind of in her personal performance, especially in the long jump, coming as the reigning indoor champion, and having 3 fouls in the prelims to not advance to finals.
I jumped before in the flight before her, so I don't know if just us not doing well maybe affected her having to go out there and feel like she had to do really well. But we ended up only having one person who was actually our multi get any points in the long jump.
Asha's kind of notorious for struggling to find the board at times, especially if she doesn't warm up well. You know, we were struggling to find the board. She was behind kind of her mark for me. She was constantly over that. No matter how much I moved her back, it was the same amount. So I knew kind of going in that we were flirting with fire a little bit. It was very difficult as a coach to see that happen to her, especially because she had been doing so well throughout the entire indoor season. I mean, last year, Asha kind of took everyone by surprise with winning the conference championship. And this year, she had been at the top, I think, pretty much since day one.
Personally, yeah, it was traumatic. luckily, I mean, you know, I'm not sure I would change it, though, because I think it made me a better person and really made me think about some stuff as far as where I fall on the team, where I want to go. I think one of my most proud moments in my life to this point is that triple jump competition, honestly. Just knowing that it was in there somehow.
But you know, she came back the second day and actually ended up winning triple, which was a complete surprise to all of us. Huge PR. Her and Janelle went 1-2. And I think Shema was in there for 4 or 5, somewhere in there.
Of course, it was really painful to watch the long jump and how it went, but then it was great to watch the triple jump and see how she managed to bounce back. And it's really, really tough, because I think we've all been in that place where we had a really important competition and then fouled out with like three foul jumps, no mark and nothing. And I honestly do not think that I could have went back the next day and did what she did.
I think it was really admirable that she was able to pull out a win in the triple jump after defeating herself in the long jump the previous day. So I think the moment that stood out was her scratching all of her jumps that long jump. That was like the most shocking thing ever. But I think her as an individual at that meet was a testament to resilience and being able to bounce back, and that's what you have to do.
Asha had a, maybe she knows, maybe she doesn't, but she had a really big foul early on in the year that was well above 13 meters. So I mean, I knew that she was capable of jumping far. She just had to let it happen, and that's ultimately what she did on that second day.
That was definitely an experience I'll never forget. They were just so supportive, and you know, Janelle is an incredible triple jumper. She consistently jumps well. I had a PR today, and the fact that her instant reaction was just happy for me shows a lot of character. It really does.
Conference would have to be like my favorite meet, because I was so happy when Asha jumped in her PR and triple jump. I don't know, it kind of makes me happier when other people do their thing rather than myself.
I think she just knew how much that success in that moment meant to me, given the long jump the day before. And so that was when she had put herself, you know, behind me.
That stood out to me as well, because I'm standing back. I got fourth place in the event, so I'm like happy about that. But I'm like observing as well, and to her reaction as soon as Asha jumped, that was extreme celebration for her.
Ever since I've come here, you know, I've really wanted to build a team. And so for me, that's, you know, it's very humbling to see. And it speaks volumes kind of about Janelle.
My favorite meet is always conference, because that's the most important one. And especially this year, it was just, it was great because the whole team had like, was performing at their best. We were entered not as like the number one team, basically. Colorado State was supposed to win it, and then we just pulled off a complete team effort. Everybody just did great, and just the whole dynamic of the meet was insane. And it was, I mean, at the end of the day, we won it, so it was great.
So then I guess you could say my favorite meet was winning conference, indoor conference. It was fun. I was, like I said, mentally, I was feeling like I was back with the team again. It was our back-to-back championship title, so that was a fun meet.
You know, everyone did a great job. There were lots of PRs that meet. Lots of season bests, so I think that was our best.
Everyone's a lobo. I said everyone's a lobo.
So indoor nationals is you need to position yourself in the top 16 in the nation, and that is after scratches occur. So this year we had Alan in the long jump, he went in 16th.
Competing for New Mexico, Alan Hamilton.
You say nationals, it's quite weird with obviously being, you have to make top 16, which is obviously kind of frustrating, because then when you look at the national rankings, you then have some completely random guys that you've been beating all year who have been jumping low sevens, and all of a sudden they pop out a 780 out of nowhere, and then they can make nationals off that, and that could knock you out. And I mean, they'll probably go nationals and probably won't go near that again. So I'll just, if you can hit it, you hit it.
For me as a coach, it was probably one of the less nerve-wracking meets that I've been to in terms of nationals in the past few years, just because I know Alan is very consistent, and he is a competitor. You know, Alan is a very seasoned person, especially with him being in grad school. He's been in big competitions before, so for me it was nice in terms of showing him where he needs to be, kind of letting him do his thing. Check marks here and there, but for the most part, just letting him kind of get into the zone and not having to worry, you know, is he overthinking things or things like that.
I knew I had to pull something out. I mean, I needed to get another personal best, especially nationals. So that's what I did. That was good. Happy to come out, was sick. First time nationals, completely different experience, completely different atmosphere, so I'm happy. I mean, nationals is nationals. I mean, to come at that kind of caliber of meet, make All-American, and then also be involved in the jump where two guys went 2 and 3 in the world indoors, like, that's ridiculous. Ridiculous to see, ridiculous to be a part of.
I mean, you've got 16 athletes and you're coming into a competition and you're basically going to split it, and only 8 end up on that podium, and 8 earn first team All-American. So yeah, I mean, it was just a sigh of relief, because if you look back at Alan, it was very much, he had that big jump that got him there early, and then we were kind of struggling to find the rhythm and find that jump again. But then once he got out on the runway, he had an indoor PR and some of the best performances of his year. I mean, with Alan coming off of indoor nationals, we waited to open him up until the first trip to California. And he opened up with 3 jumps over 770, which he's never done in his life.
Coming into competition, didn't know what shape I was in. It's the first thing of outdoors, pretty much. And then jumping 78, like, ridiculously flat, foot way out, hips low. I was like, wow, okay, that kind of sets me up for the rest of the year. Like, I'm going to have a good season.
For heat one of the women's 4x400 meter relay, running in lane 1, St. Thomas.
But I have really had fun when we went to LA. That was a nice meet. And I think I did okay in the triple jump. I think that was one of the further jumps that I did.
was a rough meet, especially it was tough. The conditions were tough. It was, I think, tough individually, and nobody in the team did well. And that whole combination of those three things together just made it a rough weekend.
That was a hard meet for a few reasons. I mean, they got in really late. Flights were delayed. We flew in Friday night. They didn't get in until almost 11 p.m. And then we were up early the next day to compete. And the weather wasn't great. So I think that really kind of messed with everyone's psyche.
Yeah, San Diego was 100% the worst. It's probably one of the worst kind of conditions ever, because I mean, it wasn't like a full-on headwind, but it was crosswind into a headwind. And it was just like, 1 minute it's there, and a minute it's like, oh, it's not there anymore. Couldn't really hit the board. And me being me, it kept getting really pissed off.
I had 3 fouls in that competition, and I honestly, that day I was like, probably it was good that I didn't record a mark, because I wouldn't want to see that mark stand next to my name. Like, with how I felt that day, it was terrible. It was terrible jumping, and it's shitty to say that, but I was glad there was no mark standing next to my name that day.
I kind of wish there wasn't on mine. It's like a 720 or something. I was like, oh no, ridiculous.
It was like super windy, super raining, and I think I qualified for finals with like a 37-foot jump. And it was so weird because Janelle unfortunately didn't qualify for finals. Nobody was at the track except for our managers, and my coaches were there, and the trainer was there, and it was dark outside. There was one light on, and randomly I pulled off a good enough jump to qualify for finals. Then I think that was my most memorable moment, I guess, just because it was just like the worst conditions possible. I ended up doing not good, but enough to qualify for finals. And right before that, I just remember the tent blowing across, the huge tent blowing across the track, almost hitting somebody on the runway. That was a really eventful, I think, meet.
Fight the power is all I have to say.
I think if I could go back and change something, I would have wanted to have redshirted my freshman year, sophomore year, and just save that eligibility to train, to, you know, sharpen some skills, get better, work on some other things.
Asha struggled a lot her first 2 years here. You know, we talked earlier kind of about that communication. And Asha and I just couldn't quite get that communication all the way there. Or we couldn't get things to fire the way we wanted them to fire. And so the first 2 years was really rough for Asha. And then her junior year is really when it started to click. So the decision to redshirt was to give more time, one, for her to develop, two, to kind of help sort some issues out with her, I guess, deficiencies on the track. And just give her a little more time to mature as an athlete and allow her and I to get that bond.
It probably was a good decision for her career, because I think she can really benefit off that extra year. And on the other hand, of course, it affected the group when we were traveling, because as I said earlier, it's always different when someone is missing, because we're such a small and tight group. And of course, sometimes I was like, oh, I wish Asha was here right now.
It's tough. I dealt with it, I guess, just as well as anyone could. I've seen other teammates do it, and I really kind of understood what they had gone through when they redshirted. There's times you kind of feel left out because traveling is a big thing. When you're traveling with your team, a lot of memories are made there. You're going to these meets together, you're spending all that time together. And you know, the joke is you have nothing to do on the weekends because all your friends are gone. Your teammates are gone, your friends are gone. And I missed them. When you're redshirting, yeah, it's less pressing because you're not dealing, your teammates aren't dealing with that pressure of, okay, like, hey, you know, you gotta get qualified for regionals, nationals. All right, we're in conference, you gotta do, like, let's get these marks, let's do well. It's just, not to say I don't think they care, but yeah, it's kind of like, okay, Asha's on hold. She's on a break, for lack of better words, I guess.
Well, it's frustrating, especially when you go back and review the tape and it's clear as day a fair mark. So, it's frustrating.
Is it a foul?
I feel like this is probably like the worst part of a jumper's career. Because, I mean, unlike sprinting or unlike like running, when they scratch or like false start, they don't get to see what happens. We see what happens and you're like, no, that was like all I had. That was the best jump ever. But I think it also helps us because you see what you're capable of in that time. And you're like, well, if I can scratch this and I was only a centimeter over the board, I can not scratch it and still get an amazing mark.
Those girls, Janelle, Casey, Shema, they jumped in probably some of the worst conditions that we had jumped in all year. I mean, there were puddles on the runway, but again, I mean, we've been in those conditions, so they knew how to handle it.
During my competition long jump, it was pouring down, raining the whole time. But I mean, it was equal environment for everybody, so it wasn't like it was just raining when I jumped. It was raining for everybody, but it made for an interesting competition. I think it was different. I felt more free, I guess, not as stressed. It's kind of hard when you look around, you have perfect elements, and you think everything should go perfectly, and then you start thinking about what overthinking things, I think. But the rain, I think, kind of lessened the tension, I guess. I think that long jump went sporadically well because, like I said, I was a little bit more carefree. Not that I wasn't caring, but mentally, I was just relaxed.
She was nowhere near even supposed to be in that field. But, you know, then again, we competed in the rain. And I mean, all you have to do is show up and be top nine and you get a chance to get there. So for her, it was definitely scoring at conference in the long jump.
Yes. The 25-foot, 1/2-inch mark, New Mexico junior Alan Hamilton.
Today's all about points, so today was just like, go out there and hit it hard and see what I can come away with. I knew I could jump far. I didn't really know what to expect, but happy to come away with gold, to be honest.
If he has the chance to win, he's gonna do whatever it takes. And I think that's what we all love about Alan. Like, he'll do whatever it takes to win or like fight for his team. So yeah, that wasn't surprising at all. And I think some people were a little bit happy that happened. But I don't think it was a surprise at all.
Yeah, I mean, I think that Savage, I mean, Alan is a very fierce competitor. And You know, we put a lot on his plate this year, especially at the conference level. Just in terms of events that he could score in and things like that. But I wouldn't have done it if Alan didn't want to do it.
I mean, I don't mind doing it. I don't mind doing it because, I mean, I've done it before. I mean, I did it when I was in high school. And then I did it a little bit afterwards, not really. Because then we kind of focused on long jump back home. So I already know I can kind of triple jump, but it hurts a lot, especially when you get it wrong. But I mean, coming into it, it was fine. I mean, I didn't know where I would place, what I would do, because I've not done it in so long. So it was actually nice to come out and then, like, well, obviously win DPR, but still, and then win conference title outdoors.
It was very exciting. When it comes to jumping, and especially in these kind of competitions, you are here for your team, but you are here to compete and get your marks and support other people as well. So I was very pleased with everything that's going on, and I was very excited to complete my goals.
A lot of people don't know this, but I have depression. I don't know why this season, it started coming up during meets. So like before I would compete, I would get really depressed. And that happened at conference. So when I PR'd, I didn't really feel anything. And I know everyone else was excited and I was like, oh, I should be really excited. But it didn't like faze me. That kind of bothered me, but I still got my mark, so I'm happy with that, but it was just a weird situation. I don't think I've ever experienced that before. At first, I guess I was kind of ashamed of it, only because I think that when other people hear it, they like, oh, you want to kill yourself all the time. That's what you want to do. Like, that's what depressed people want to do. You just like, you see a window, you want to jump out of it. Like, that's not how it works. Everyone thinks I'm like the life of the party. Like, Janelle's always so happy. She always cheers me up when I feel bad. But I don't know, I think for the most part, it gives me perspective. Because I know what it's like to feel bad. So when I see someone feel bad, I automatically want to cheer them up. And I think that's what everyone sees me as, like the person that makes everyone like happier and whatever else. So I guess that'll make sense for them. I don't see it as like a disease or something to hold me back. Like, I'm not different because I have it. I'm just sadder than the average person. And sometimes certain things hit me where other people don't get hit. And I'm more sensitive to certain things, but I'm still the same person. The track family helps. Not as far as the sport. I mean, I love the sport, but being around Coach Austin, being around the team, really helps on bad days. That was Shema's last track meet as a D1 athlete. I think that was a very touching situation.
I said, all right, well, I didn't qualify for regionals in the long jump, but I was pleased with my performance. So now I got to qualify for regionals in triple jump. Like, this is my last opportunity. Jump after jump, I kept telling myself. And so that was a mental barrier. And I think I was forcing every single step I put down on the track that day. And I don't like to blame any individual because I'm the one out there competing. But I get caught up in a lot of emotions. So I'm looking over at my coach and he's like extremely excited for what Janelle's doing and not really giving me the feedback that I need to like get out of this stuck mindset. And I don't think he noticed it. Granted, he was saying like, all right, let's do this. You gotta get after that. But mentally, I was already broken. So him saying that wasn't enough for me. And I wish I could have communicated that to him at the time. Looking back, I definitely regret it. But It ended, and I it's over now. I mean, I didn't qualify for regionals. I didn't even get a jump that I expected to get in, and that's frustrating. Everything, I think, happened the way it was gonna happen. Sometimes there can be surprises, but unfortunately, it happened the way it did, and that was the culmination of my outdoor season.
I've seen her jump at her full potential and full health. And if you've seen her jump this year, it's a whole different story, and that's a shame, to be honest. Because she could have done so much better. And it's kind of a shame that her track career ended like that, because I think she could have went a lot further. She could have went further, definitely, than she did.
Oh, my God.
I feel like Shimmel was, like, a huge part of the team, because she's so, like, funny and lively, and everybody loves to pick on Shimma, and like, just her presence is beautiful. And I think that losing her was, I think, really emotional for everyone. And that's when everyone started crying.
I think regionals in general is like a really tough meet, because basically you can only lose in that meet. Like, nobody's gonna remember the guy that won regionals, but you can certainly get eliminated and don't even have a shot at a national championship. I mean, it was a ridiculously strong meet. Of course, I thought after the first flight that my chances were really good of making it. And then watching the second flight and realizing that I'm gonna get knocked out was tough. Especially going into regionals, I didn't have like the best meets. Yeah, conference, it was kind of unfortunate because I just didn't hit the board and I didn't jump terrible, but I also didn't jump good. And so I did not know if I would be able to pull it off at regionals. And then actually getting it together in the last attempt was definitely, it was great. Now that's definitely something that's gonna help me.
I have no idea how long he's had that PR since he was like 11. No, just kidding, 15 or something. So to break that was like, everyone was really happy about that.
He's dealt with injuries. He's dealt with little things happening here and there. He works really hard in school. And to have a PR of his life at regionals just killed me that he didn't go, because he did do so well. He did compete so well. It's just everyone else did that day too.
You've had such a bad start to the outdoor season, and then you've had these injuries, you've not been able to do what you want to do, you've had to take so many step backs in training, and all of a sudden, bang, you can hit it right at the right time and smash a PB. I mean, that's ridiculous. I've never seen someone do that, ever. This guy, just this guy. I don't know what else to say, honestly. This guy's awesome.
Thank you.
Tough one, obviously. I don't know. Obviously, then with seeing Yannick, obviously coming up with PR, I was over just in the tent. Okay, that's great. We can push forward, we can do this. Obviously, I've never done regionals. This is completely new, the whole system out here. So to be honest, I didn't really know what to expect. And then coming to the meet, I was okay. A solid performance should get me to nationals. It won't be anything, don't need to put anything special out. And then first round hit, 1x181. And I was like, okay, I don't know who this guy is. This guy's just gone something not too bad. And then everyone just went off. Just people were hitting jumps out of nowhere. Especially when it's only three rounds, I did something you just did not expect. And then, I don't know, as soon as it got to the final round, and then...
You make it.
It's not ideal. It's just not ideal at all.
Fuck's sake!
I actually couldn't watch. I guess it was kind of frustrating because one of the guys before as well, a guy from Cali, he got a remeasure and ended up being 780. Which knocked me down again, so I was like, okay, I'm in like 12th position.
There's three jumpers left. Two of them can hit a jump to move Alan out. One of them being the Oregon kid, because he's done it before.
I haven't competed as well as I wanted to. and then realizing, okay, there's one guy left, there's one guy that can take off me, and it is this guy. And I was like, I just can't watch. Nope, couldn't do it.
So, sure enough, comes down the runway. He's got 5 meter tailwind, 783.
Not being able to like come back or see or do anything about it really. And watching the guys Morgan and stuff just come out and pop the lifetime best out of nowhere. It's just like, what can you do?
4:13.73, the all-time best.
And then it was just funny because hearing Scott and the other rest of the guys in the squad, just like Coach Cerrone's and Coach Austin's face when he landed, it was just like, gone. That's it, done. And I was just like, that's it. It's over. So it's also kind of annoying as well, but hey, it's the way competitions go. I mean, you come out and then jump like pretty respectively and meaning what in the 770s, and then legal wins, and then all of a sudden someone goes way further with like plus five, and it's just like,
you know, hard pill to swallow, but you know, sometimes that's just the way the cookie crumbles. And you know, we did exactly what we could do. It was just one of those years where we jumped well and everyone jumped even better.
To Eugene Morgan, I'd like to recognize our competitors in flight three.
I think outdoor it's worse because you're actually at the meet when it happens. Because like indoor, you just look at the marks and you're like, oh, I didn't get in. But outdoor, you're competing and you're like, I didn't do it.
I've worked with Janelle, this is 2 years now, you know, it's not, I know her fairly well. Her and I have, I guess, a connection that is very strong, and I think it's just our personalities are very similar in that regard. And in that competition, she just didn't look like she normally does. I mean, it stands out to me this day. Never in a competition has she asked me, what do I need to jump? She's always just gone out and jumped and competed at the best she can. And so right, and that was, you know, that was approaching third round is when that happened. And so, you know, that kind of took me a little bit aback. I think only Janelle can tell you kind of what she was feeling that day. But it was just, what I noticed was that she didn't look herself. You as a coach know, you know, it's not all right. It's not great, but you know, you're still alive, you're still kicking.
Everything works out in different ways, not always the way you plan it.